Okay, so first is the introduction. So the porous medium, it is a solid matrix with voids or pores, which are continuously connected. These voids are filled with one or more fluids, and that can pass through the medium because the voids are interconnected. So porous medium is nothing but if the solid zone or solid material has some cavities inside it, but these cavities must be connected for flow processes, and otherwise it is also a porous medium, but the flow will not be possible if the pores are not connected. Okay, so some examples where we see transport in the porous medium are heat pipes used in the electronic devices to cool it down, biological tissues. The tissues like skin or bones have pores in it. Fuel cells, filters. Filters is the most common example, right? We see it in daily life. The catalytic converter, like the silencer of our bikes, automobile vehicles. Granular beds, also in concrete and road structures. Okay. So there are some terms related to porous medium, which will be like required to understand the mechanism. So first is the porosity. So the porosity is nothing but the void fraction or total volume of the void or cavity inside that solid structure per unit the total volume. So it is giving us the idea in that given structure, how much volume, how much fraction of volume is vacant or void is there. So fluid will be filling that void. Okay. So types of voids. There are three types of voids. First is isolated void. We can see. So this void is not connected to any other voids. Second is non-interconnected voids. So these voids are connected, but there is no it has some dead end. There is no possibility of flow. It can fill some fluid, but the flow will not be possible. Third is interconnected void. So voids like this, which have interconnection, and the fluid will be able to transport or travel through it. Okay, so this interconnected voids are most useful for our purpose. Based on those type of voids, there are two kinds of porosity: true porosity and effective porosity. So in the true porosity, all the voids are accounted, whether it is connected or disconnected or interconnected. Okay, so total volume of void upon total volume will give us true porosity. But our desirable means our requirement is effective porosity, where only the porosity or only the pores which are connected, which are able to make the flow possible, the flow will be possible from that channel, is accounted. So so this is defined in like the volume of interconnected voids upon the total volume of solid matrix plus volume of all the voids. Okay, so there are some methods to measure this porosity, like bulk volume, as a direct method, where we compare the bulk volume, then after crushing it, we compare it to the crushed volume. So the crushed volume will give us the volume of solid matrix, and the bulk volume will give us the volume of all, like void plus solid matrix. So we can compare, and we can find out the volume of voids, volume of solid matrix, and then we can find out the porosity. Second is photochromic method, where we take a cross section, and then we take the image, and then we compare the amount of voidness present in that cross section area. Okay. Also, there are two more methods where we fill the liquid. In one case, the liquid must be like waiting, like water or liquid metal. In second case, it must be non-metallic, like mercury. Okay, so we fill that porous medium with the liquid, and then we measure that liquid which has filled the voids. So it will give us the volume of void, and after measuring the total volume, we can get the porosity. So these are like basic idea of porosity. Second is permeability. So permeability is a measurement of flow conductance of the given porous medium to the fluid flowing through it. Okay. Yes, sir.
Sorry for interruption. Could you please check your mic setting? Actually, it is overlapping and like a little bit disturbance.
Okay. I'm sorry for that. I will check. The next quantity is permeability. It is similar to the resistance. Like in electrical circuits, we have voltage difference, and due to that voltage difference, current flows through the wire, and that wire has some resistance. Similarly, if we compare the analogy between them, the channel has some pressure difference, which is acting as potential difference or voltage difference. Then in that case current was flowing, here the fluid will flow, and at that place the resistance was there, electrical resistance. So in this place, the permeability or inverse of the permeability actually is the reverse of the resistance. So if the medium has more permeability, means it has less resistance to the upcoming flow. Okay, so this is called Dorsey's relation, and we can use this relation to measure the pressure drop and the velocity, flow velocity, and then we can measure the permeability. Okay, so it is a complex function of porosity, pore size, shape factor, and distribution of pores in the medium. And till now, there is no general relationship for it. We measure it experimentally. Okay, the unit is meter square. Okay, so I think it is sufficient to like get the idea of permeability. So next is tortuosity. So tortuosity is it is also a geometric property which measures the straightness of the conduit or the path. So if we see this free figure, so this figure, if we take this channel, so this blue line showing the minimum path, which is straight, and this red line is showing the actual path, so it is not straight. So this tortuosity is measurement of this actual path upon the minimum path. So if the imagine that if the pores are randomly distributed, the path to the path of fluid flow will be tortuous or not straight. Okay, so this is very effective in creating the, like we will see some phenomena in porous medium. It is called dispersion, hydrodynamic and thermal dispersions. So it is which helps in spreading of that the transport quantities like velocity, momentum or temperature. So this is actually helpful for our purpose. Okay, so next is length scale. So we should have an idea of length scales used in this porous medium. So I am taking one sample of this example. So there are actually four length scales. So this capital L is showing the volume of the porous medium. So suppose a channel is filled with porous medium, so the diameter of that channel will be this length scale maximum. Second is a small L. It is showing the size of elementary volume. So this volume, this box is showing elementary volume. It is like a unit cell. So we if we repeat this unit cell structure, we can get an idea of how these pores are distributed in the medium. Okay, so that scale is called REP scale, or representative elementary volume scale. Sorry, REV scale. Okay. Then next is more smaller scale is D. D means the size of the pore. It is visible here. And the last or most smallest length scale is under root K. So this K is permeability. This root K is showing us, it is called Brinkmann scaling length, and it shows us the thickness of the boundary layer formed. So the boundary layer is very important in transport processes. We will see. But you should have some idea of the boundary layer, hydrodynamic boundary layer and thermal boundary layer. Okay. So next is the relationship between porosity and permeability. And as I have already told, there is no general relationship. There is no formula to find out the permeability from the porosity. But we have three models, three approximations to find out that. So these are called capillary model first, then hydraulic radius model, and last is drag model. So in capillary model, what we do, we actually take those small channels, small conduits present in the porous structure, and we apply the basic fluid flow equations, Navier-Stokes equations, and then we take this average value to get the idea of permeability. Second is most useful, where this is an approximate model, where we take the permeability as a function of tortuosity, porosity, and pore size, and we get after some measurements, experimental procedures, we get the relationship between porosity and permeability. So this is very famous. It is called Karman-Kozny theory. And the last is used only for the periodic structures. So suppose the pores have some periodicity, like in sieves or in filters, we get these structures. So we have this idea of how this it is distributed. So in that case, we can use this model. So for now, it is not important. I'm just giving the idea, okay? So this was, till now we have seen the basic properties of porous media. Now we'll see what are the equations used in the porous media. So first we will do Eulerian volume averaging, because what is the problem? The pore size is very small and we are not able to resolve till that scale. So what we'll do, we'll take some sufficiently large volume, which is called representative elementary volume. We have seen in the few sites back. And we take the, we do the volume averaging of the variables like velocity, pressure, temperature, density, etc. Okay. And this process is called Eulerian volume averaging. So there are two kinds of averaging. One is intrinsic phase average, second is extrinsic phase average. So this formula looks almost same, but the difference is this volume which we are taking to take the average value. Okay. So this VK is the volume of that phase only. Suppose a porous medium is filled with the liquid or water. This is only the volume of the water, not the total medium. Okay, so by this averaging, we get the average value for the liquid only. For example, we have taken the example of liquid. In the second case, we take the total volume. So total volume, we get the total outcome, a total value of variable like temperature. So this temperature, if we get by this formula, it is not the temperature of liquid or temperature of solid, it is temperature of this medium. Okay, so that's how we differentiate between intrinsic, means only for the depth phase, and extensiveness for the total medium. Okay, and there is one relationship between these two averages. It is called Tupuit-Fort-Chambers relationship. Okay. So after doing this volume averaging, we apply this conservation laws. So first is conservation of mass. So by the conservation of mass, we get the situation where for that given volume, the total inlet or incoming, we can say liquid or fluid, the incoming mass of incoming fluid and mass of outgoing fluid will be balanced by the generation term. So the mass is always conserved. It cannot be created nor be destroyed. So this is the mathematical version of saying the same thing, okay, in case of fluids, okay. Second is the conservation of momentum. So in porous medium, there are various stages of developing this formula. So it started from Darcy. Okay. So first, in 1856, this study of this porous medium, flow in porous medium, started from this work of Henry Darcy. So who came up with this relationship between the pressure drop in the channel filled with the porous medium and the velocity through that medium. Okay, so it was for very low Reynolds number. You know, Reynolds number, if it is low, it means the velocities are very small. It is very slow. The flow is very slow. It will be laminar flow, or we can say viscous flow, and its velocity will be very small. So only for that case, Darcy derived this formula. Okay, so which is saying the total force here, the gravitational force or the weight of the fluid and the pressure drop, pressure difference is balancing with this like momentum term. So this is actually the momentum, we can say momentum term. So this, okay. So next, that was for the low Reynolds number. If the velocities are little higher, we have to add one inertial term. So in the same formula or the same equation, there is one modification of this inertial loss term. Okay, so for the higher speeds, there is more losses. So you can imagine, suppose if you are riding a bike, if your speed, means if your speed is increasing, you will feel more drag. So it is kind of that same analogy we can apply here. Okay, more is the speed, more is the loss, loss in the pressure. Next, the same formula, same Darcy formula is modified for the wall interactions. So if the channel filled with porous material has some, is attached with the wall, this wall applies viscous forces. Some boundary layer is formed. So we have to account for that losses also. So it is accounted by this term. It is called Stokes term. Or in this case, it is called Brinkman term because Brinkman proposed this term. Okay, so after combining all these terms, Darcy term, which was for the viscous drop, Fort-Chambers term, which was, this is Darcy term for viscous drop. This is the inertial loss term or Fort-Chambers term for inertial drop. And this is called the Brinkman term for the wall interaction, okay, or the viscous boundary effect, we can say. Wall is making a boundary layer and it is reducing the flow by applying the viscous forces or the friction, okay? So this is the final version of our momentum law. And the next is energy law. So it is the difference between mass conservation, momentum conservation and the energy conservation is the mass and momentum conservation was were only for the fluid or the whatever liquid or gas is flowing through the porous medium. But this energy conservation is for the all, because energy is not confined to the fluids. It is for solids, fluids, everything, all the materials or even non-materials. So here we combine the fluid energy in the solid energy, and we get this type of energy equation. So the assumption is there is not heat transfer between the solid matrix and the fluid which is filled, which is filling the medium. Okay. So this effective he developed means effective properties. So we take the effect properties of both solid. This is SM is solid matrix, solid as well as the fluid. F is fluid. Okay, for conductivity, for heat capacity, and also for the this heat source. So these are the governing equations we have to see for any type of approaches. It can be computational, it can be experimental, or it can be analytical. So now we will see one test case where we will define one problem, or we will see solution of that problem in computational method. Okay. So the problem is from a heat pipe. Okay. So the heat pipes are used in electronic cooling. Like you can see this heat pipes in your smartphones, laptops, personal computers, or if you go to higher end, some electronic clusters or workstations. Okay, so heat pipes are used to dissipate or to absorb the heat from those electronic, means the electronic components like GPU, processors. Okay, these are this creates or generates a very high value of heat, okay, which is not desirable if they are not removed from that place. Okay, they can heat up the electronic system, and they can damage the materials, and they can disturb our process. Okay, so to remove those heat being generated from these GPUs or CPUs, we need these heat pipes. Okay, so the problem is the heat pipes, the size is limited for the heat pipes. We cannot exceed the size to in centimeters. It is in the range of micro channels to mini channels, or within 2 millimeter to 5 millimeters, not more than that, because we don't have the space. You use smartphone, how can you fit a pipe inside that? Okay, so that is first problem. So in the second problem, due to this small size, we cannot have pumps to make the flow possible. Okay, so we require to have a very low pressure drops or low loss in heats, so that with very small amount of pumping, we are able to make the flow possible. Okay, so I'm taking one case. One test case where we are comparing two cases. So one, the channel is completely filled with the porous medium. Second, this channel is partially filled with the porous medium. So why we are using the porous medium here? Because there is the possibility of installing a mechanical pump is not there due to small size. So we are using this capillary action generated from this porous medium. Means you can see, if suppose your table means if some water is there, you know, if you place one cloth or one tissue, it will soak all this liquid. So that is actually the pumping, means sucking is the pumping. Okay, and you are using that same phenomena for our pumping purpose. So we are taking this example. One case, it is completely filled with the porous medium. It is second case, it is partially filled with the porous medium. And this, there are heaters, four discrete heaters in the bottom wall. Okay, these boxes, small boxes, are heaters. So for this case, this Reynolds number and this Darcy number, we'll see what is Darcy number. We can see the drop in pressure in fully porous channel is very high, 10 to the power 5. In also partially porous channel, it is half than that, means it is 0.5 times the previous value. but in non-professional, it is very small. Okay, but the desirable effect is, we should have a high Nusselt number or high heat transfer coefficient. So we can see from this graph, if we fill the channel with porous medium, whether it is partially or fully, we are getting the same Nusselt number, heat transfer coefficient, and it is very large compared to this non-porous channel, the case where the channel is empty, not filled with the porous medium. Okay, so our objective is, how can we save our pumping power? Okay, so this partially porous channel is giving us a lower value of pressure drop, but we want to go lower than that if it is possible. We will see if it is possible. Okay, so what I proposed is, if we instead of using this straight or normal porous plug, what happens if we use this oblique porous plugs? Okay, in the second case, we can reduce this gap, this height also. Okay, we can create the gap so that there is a path of least resistance and this pressure will obviously drop. Okay, so I am taking example of this first case only, oblique porous plugs. Okay, so solution methodology, you have to first create that geometry and that discretize in the mesh, create the mesh in the some CAD software. So ANSYS has some software like ICM, CFD, or we can use SolidWorks or CATIA, Creo, whatever you have learned, and all are equally effective. Okay, so you have to create that geometry in that mesh, and proper meshing should be there. Then we go for this solution process. Okay, so in the partially porous channel, some part is empty, some part is filled. So we have to use both equations. So for the porous zones, we have to use Darcy equations, and for the non-porous zones, we have to use the simple version, like Navier-Stokes equations. Okay, so here for the non-porous zones, where only liquid is present, we can use these equations: mass conservation, momentum conservation, and energy conservation. Okay, for the porous medium, as we have seen, these are the extra terms. This is Darcy term, Ford-Zimmer term, and this is called Brinkman term. Okay, so we have to solve this case. These are the boundary conditions or material properties. So we are taking some material property for the liquid as well as for the solid matrix. Okay, and we are taking some we are maintaining some flow situation, like Reynolds number is 50, 100 to 50,000 for the laminar flow case. This Darcy number is the ratio of permeability and the characteristic length, square of the characteristic length. So in our case, channel height is the characteristic length. Okay, and this Prandtl number is fixed to 10. Okay, so boundary conditions are, for the inlet, we have taken uniform velocity and the uniform temperature. Okay, for the outlet, outflow boundary condition use, where we make this gradients, normal gradients of velocity or temperature equal to zero. For the bottom wall, no slip condition is applied, means where there is contact of liquid or the fluid with solid wall, it will be at rest due to large friction. Okay, for the those parts where heaters are present, we have used constant heat flux, and for the where heaters are not present, we have used this insulated boundary condition. Same with the upper wall, there is no heaters present, or for the top wall, so we have used this no slip condition for momentum and zero heat flux for the thermal boundary condition. Okay, so so these are the geometry conditions. So the channel geometry or the height is fixed to 20 millimeter. It cannot go beyond like centimeters, in centimeters. Even this is also large, but for the sake of like example, we have seen this. Inlet temperature is 300 Kelvin, room temperature, and the heat flux is 5000. So these are just the values, you can take your own values according to your own situation. This is just the example, okay? So the results are presented in the non-dimensional fashion so that we can compare with other cases, already obtained cases, okay? So non-dimensionalization means we are making those results independent from the size or the scales. For large scale, small scale, we will have same like pressure drop or temperature profile, okay? The porous medium porosity is very large, 0.97 means 97% is empty. So this is possible in metal forms, okay? The inertial loss coefficient, the drag coefficient is 0.1, and these are the values of these are the values we use in our software, NCS Fluent. For other softwares, we can have some other form of this same formula, but this will be common. This permeability or the Darcy number will be common. The C1 and C2 may differ according to the solver. Okay, so there are various solvers like OpenFOAM, NCS, Star CCM Plus, or many, but the most popular is NCS Fluent. Okay, so I'm using that. So now after all these solutions, this is part of post-process where we'll see and analyze the results. So there are two situations taken. In one case, the obliqueness or the obliquity is in the forward direction. In the second case, it is the reverse direction with reference to the flow direction. So flow is entering from the left and exiting from the right side, okay? In this case, Reynolds number and Darcy number is fixed, and we will see what happens. What is the effect of this oblique porous flux as compared to the normal case? So this is the first result where we are seeing the effect in the velocity. So this is the normal case where these are the flux. 1, 2, 3, and 4 are the flux, and the heaters are present here, just below the porous zones. Okay, so in the normal case, this flow is very symmetric. We can see the top and bottom wall has similar kind of boundary layer formation. Okay, the second difference is in the empty zones where there is no porous medium, the flow is developing like that parabolic profile. You must have seen that Hagen-Pizzoli. It is very basic, okay? But in case of this porous medium, the velocity profile is very uniform. So it is like a slug flow or the plug flow we have seen. If we will zoom and if we'll see near the wall, we'll see very large gradient in the profile. And that is what which makes this transport processes enhanced than the normal case. So here all roughly we can see the boundary layer is thicker here. It is very thin here. So that is increasing the transport processes. This is first thing. Second thing, by introduction of this obliquity, we can see the symmetry of the flow profile is disturbed, okay? So we can see the high speed or low speed zones are separated now, okay? So this was the velocity. Let us see what happens with the pressure. So this is for the pressure. So we can see the scale is same, so we can just compare the colors. So for the normal case, starting from the red till blue, it is dropping to very large value, 16,500. It is non-dimensional, so I'm not using the units, only the numbers. So when I'm using this forward oblique case or backward oblique case for the porous plugs, I can see from red to this greenish blue. Okay, so it is dropped till like 11 or 10,000. So this is this reduction is desirable and very significant for our purpose. So the means now the advantage is we can use very small pumping power for the same flow. Okay. So this is the effect of obliquity on the pressure. We can use the graphs to represent this drop. Okay. So next is temperature. So actually the velocity and the pressure profiles were almost same for the reverse and forward oblique. We can see in the both case, it is just a mirror image. But here in the temperature, since the heaters were only placed at the bottom walls, we are seeing a difference. So if we try to analyze, so it is affecting this boundary layer, thermal boundary layer. So if it is thin, it will have a better transport of heat. And if it is thick, it will have a lower transport of heat. Okay. So we can use the graphs. So the Nusselt number is a very important number in convective heat transfer, which tells us how effectively that fluid is taking away the heat from the given surface. Okay. So in case of forward oblique plug, this dotted black line is showing us the normal case, normal plug. Okay. And we are getting this other values like this 11, 21. These are the various angles of obliquity from 0 to 45. So we can see by increasing this obliquity, there is not very much change in the Nusselt number. Okay. And in the first half, or in the first two heaters, we are getting a lower value for Nusselt number. These colorful lines are for the oblique plugs. And for the towards the exit, we are seeing the rise. So in the second case, where the backward oblique plugs are used, we are seeing a different effect. So here, in each case, in the first half, of the heater, the Nusselt numbers are higher. In the second half, it is lower. So it is balancing actually. By averaging, we are getting the same value. So we can see this table and we can compare our results with the normal case. So we can see by using this oblique plug in the forward direction, the drop in pressure is very large. And it is same for both cases, same value, -2%, 7%. It is same for both value, as we have seen the pressure plot. It was just the mirror image or the same. Okay, but in case of heat transfer, as we are increasing this obliquity in the forward direction, we are getting the reduction in the Nusselt number. So it is not desirable. So we are getting this lower pumping power requirement, but also our heat transfer coefficient is getting decreased. So if we see the second part, where we are using the backward oblique plugs, so by increasing this obliquity in the reverse direction, we can see this fall is very small. Okay, so here it was -18%, here it is only -6%. Okay, so we can conclude that by using the backward oblique plugs in case of normal plugs, we can see reduced pressure drop, but a very little change in heat transfer coefficient. Okay, so that's how we analyze the results. So the conclusion is, the pressure drops or the velocity profile is almost same, exactly same actually. It is just the mirror image for backward and forward case. Okay, in case of the forward oblique plug, the heat transfer was decreasing, but in case of backward oblique plugs, it is decreasing, but very small changes there. Okay, so the final winners are these two values, the minus 38 degree or minus 45 degree, where we are getting a very reduced pressure drop or pumping power requirement with very small change in the heat transfer coefficient. Okay, so this was a test case for modeling this porous medium. Okay, we need to, so I will show you what is the geometry and what is this, how to assign the parameters. So I'm showing inlet, outlet. So this is our case, that same channel. It is in 3D. So, okay, this is inlet and this is outlet. The red color is outlet. Okay. So if I will remove this upper top channel, we can see the plugs. These are the plugs. Okay. So actually this channel is completely empty in these two ribs or two blocks are there, which we need to assign as porous blocks. So for that, I will go in the sail zone conditions, and there are two blocks, two different zones. One is fluid zone, which is empty, and second is block. So right now it is assigned as solid. For modeling it as a porous medium, we have to convert it into fluid. Okay. So once it is converted into fluid, we have to on this porous zone. Okay. So if you activating this porous zone, this panel is opened and we can give the values of our properties. Okay. So what are the properties we need to provide? First is the porosity. Okay. So one means it is completely non-porous. There is no like porosity. So if you assign is some 0.6 means 60% voidness. Zero means it is completely solid. There is no porosity. One means completely empty. Fluid is complete. There is no solid matrix. So the practical case is 0.4 or 0.6. We have, so that we have 40% or 60% voidness. Okay. Second is we need to give this direction. So these directions are some preferred directions. Suppose we have honeycomb structure or we have some filters. Like if you will see your air filter of your bike or car, it is honeycombed in structure. So it has some preferred direction of like in one direction is it has the void, in other direction it is opaque. So we can assign those directions from here. So x1, y0, z0, it means x direction. Or similarly, if I will give x0 or y1 means y direction. So first we have to fix the direction, then we have to provide that at c1 and c2 coefficients. Okay, so the c1 is inverse of the permeability, okay, viscous resistance, and the c2 is inverse of that. It is a simple function. It is the viscous resistance or the Darcy term, and this is the inertial resistance or the Fortimer term. Okay, and here this thermal model means equilibrium means there is no heat transfer between the solid matrix and the fluid which is filling that matrix. Okay, we can assign the material of that solid matrix. Here it is aluminium. We can give some other value, carbon, steel, or other. Okay. We have one more value. It is called relative viscosity. So we can use Brinkman or other terms. So this relative viscosity is actually some function of fluid viscosity and porosity and tauticity depending on the model used. Okay. So most used model is Brinkman model for the Brinkman term. Okay. So these are the settings you have to give. Okay. Hello, sir. Okay. So, for non-dimensionalizing the pressure, there are two approaches. We can use the dynamic pressure. This is dynamic pressure, rho velocity square. It is like kinetic energy. Okay. So, and in some case, we use this viscous term also. It is depending on the Reynolds number. This is the first approach. Means in the first approach, we use dynamic pressure for non-dimensionalizing the pressure or pressure scaling. Or we can use the like mu u naught by L. It is the like shear stress. For the temperature, if the condition is constant heat flux, then we can use this formula. This is actually, okay. Again, there are two approaches. One is for constant wall temperature. Second is for constant heat flux case. So for the constant heat flux, we use this formula for this scale, and for the constant fall, we use that formula T fall minus T upon T wall minus T inlet or T bulk mean. So these are the like these informations we can get from standard books like in Copra or Sengel. Okay, for non-dimensionalizing this length scales, we have used this channel width, which was characteristic length of the channel of the case. And this inlet velocities are used for velocities. So these are means fundamental variables, velocity, pressure, and temperature. For other cases, we can take some reference or help of the books or the standard literatures available.
So how to define influent, sir?
I will show you. So for non-dimensionalizing, we have to redefine those variables using this linear-defined functions. So there's one setup called linear-defined functions where we can, So linear-defined functions are different. We have to use the custom field functions. Okay, for customizing the variables. So here I have used this non-dimensional pressure, and that's x direction, y direction scale, length scales, z direction scale, and this velocity, velocity of in the x direction upon inlet velocity. Similarly for the y direction and the temperature. So this is how means we can define. So suppose I need to define some other variable. So I can select it from this menu. Like suppose density is there, I can select density is coming here. So I can scale it up or scale it down using that factor. Okay, suppose that factor is known as 0.8. I can define it as density. So I can assign some value. So dimension is density, like that. I can define and I can use it for my post-process results. Calculating the Nusselt number, we need to require the wall temperature and the bulk mean temperature for every like axial positions for calculating the local Nusselt number. So it is not possible to do it from, or it is possible, but that value or the data is not sufficient to give us the exact result. So we can import that value in this CFD post, the post process, and we can look. I will show you by one case. So I'm importing that result. put some data. So based on the like specification of your system, it will take some time. So this is the case, this is the channel, this is the inlet and outlet, and these are two porous zones, and the heaters are just below these porous zones. Other volume is empty, or it is filled with the liquid. So I okay, so I have created one code for calculating those. It looks like this. It is not very difficult. It is looking very complex, but it's very simple. Okay. So I have created one surface at the inlet, and I have taken, means I am computing it or extending it for 351 or 350 surfaces. So this is the like a code for that. First from 1 to 351, and we are calculating these values. Like for the ball temperature, I'm using maximum value for those surfaces. For the bulk mean, I'm using mass flow average for those surfaces. And similarly, we can compute other values like pressure or mass flow or whatever we want. Okay. So if I will like load this season data or this code, this is how we do it. Season. Clay season. I have that. This NUM is Nusselt number and pumping power calculation. So I have named it like this. It will take some time. Please wait. Okay, it is loaded now. So we can see there are many surfaces created. Okay. So these are the number of surfaces created by that code. So 350 surfaces are created, or 351 surfaces are created. Okay. So if I will click on this table, which is generated from that same code, I can see these are the value of like wall temperature, bulk mean temperature, or the pressure on this axial locations. So I can use this data for computing my heat transfer coefficient. Okay, so this is how we can do. This post processor is it can be used, it could be used for many other purposes. It is just a sample.